Remember that Pastor has pledged from this church $5,000 to go to the I Am Global offering and to help build a church in Washington, D.C. And I believe of all the places in America, we need a good church in Washington, D.C. Can you say amen? And to our Fusion and Hyphen students, something you may not know about that offering, Brother Tim and Brother Mark have gotten together and they have pledged that $500 of that $5,000 is going to come from Fusion and Hyphen students. So you guys be praying about what you're going to give in that offering. There's going to be a Super Bowl party tonight for Hyphen at 5:30 at the Koogler's house. Please bring a side, chips, or dessert, and $3 for pizza. And the address is right there listed in the bulletin. This Tuesday is our ministerial alliance. That's from 7 to 8. Pastor wanted me to stress that this is for not only our ministers, but also their spouses. He really wants the spouses to come. This month, we're going to be watching a video from Because of the Times by Pastor J.H. Osborne. And our pastor believes that this video explains perfectly why we do what we do as ministers. So ministers and your spouses, please make plans to be here for our ministerial alliance this Tuesday at 7. And finally this morning, our sweetheart banquet is going to be February 21st at TJ Chump's in Huber Heights at 6 p.m. Pastor Norman Pasley will be speaking for that. And today after service, please see Sister Stephanie Gifford to get signed up for the sweetheart banquet. Some good news from last week. We had two people get baptized in Jesus' name, Todd Marshall and Angela Frazier. I think we need to stand to our feet this morning and give the Lord a hand clap of praise for not only what he did last week, but what we expect him to do this morning, and worship with the praise team.
Thank you. Called to prepare our hearts to love him, to serve him, to draw near to him. That's our calling today. And what Jesus would like us to know is that he is here for us. He is here for you. You may have come into this building feeling like you were friendless. You may come into this building and you may feel like you're all alone. Nobody's there for you. You've come in here sick. You've come in here broken. You've brought all your broken pieces with you in your little pocket of goodies, as you would call it. And yet Jesus said this. He said, "Come unto me, and I will give you rest." And then he said this. We have forgotten how to do this. He said, "Learn of me." What have you learned about him this week? Have you learned that he loves you with an everlasting love? And that his hand is outstretched still, it is not shortened. That no matter where you are at today, no matter how deep the pit you are in, grace reaches for you. And so we're going to go before the Lord right now. We are before him right now. I don't know if you feel his presence, but I do know that he is here for you. And if you just open your life up to him and say, "God, I open all the doors that I have closed for such a long time. And I'm asking you to come into my life. I'm asking you to take whatever you want in my life and make it beautiful. Take what I have as brokenness and strife and make something beautiful out of my life." Learn of him, how much he loves you. We're going to come before the Lord in prayer. And for those that have a need, to those who know that God can meet their needs, I'd like you to come. I'd like you to come right now. I'd like you to come right now. Don't wait. Just come on. And we're going to before the Lord right now. In the name of Jesus, we come to you just as we are. We don't have a lot to give you, Jesus. All we have is ourselves. All we have is our minds and our hearts and all of our spirits. We have our brokenness. We have our strives. We have our pains. We have everything, Lord God, that this world has tried to give us. But we give it to you, God, because we know that you can heal a broken hearted You can mend a broken life. You can bring joy and give it for mourning. You can take the darkness that is in our lives and bring light. Oh, what joy we find in you, Jesus. You take the weariness away from us, oh God, and you give us courage. You give strength, Lord God, when we are weak. Oh, Lord God, you take all of our confusion and you bring us peace. In the name of Jesus, Lord God, everybody, let's begin to praise the Lord today. Let's begin to love him like we've loved him never before. Lord Jesus, we love you today. We love you today, Jesus. We love you today.
Come on, hallelujah. We bless you, Lord. you, Lord. We want you, Lord. Yeah, yeah. Oh, we want you, Lord.
More and more.
More and more.
More and more.
More and more.
Continue in this house. Father, we love you. You're great. Father, the earth testifies of your goodness. We thank you, God, that you are great. You are awesome. You are glorious. We're thankful for the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. 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 Glory. Hallelujah. You're wonderful, Jesus. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father. Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, if you came here today needing a touch from the Master, hallelujah, I'm glad that we don't just have to read about Jesus, but he's active and here today, that if you need a touch, you need a breakthrough, you need a miracle, then you came to the right place on a Sunday morning. Hallelujah. You know, the Bible talks about Jesus being a refuge and a strength and a strong tower for those who are hurting and those who are in need. And if you need that today, friend, I don't just say that for it's a good cliche. I say that because I found it to be true in my own life. I found God when I need a helper, I need a friend, I need a refuge, I need a shelter. Jesus Christ is that shelter. Hallelujah. As the ushers could prepare to bring our tithe and the offering, you know, Brother Billy talked about how today was missions offering. And you know, sometimes people don't realize just how important giving to missions is, because you know, there's some parts of the world that have never heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. There's some parts of the world that are Muslim nations that don't allow the Christian faith and the gospel to be preached. So we believe that if you give to that, amen, you're giving to help further the gospel and further the kingdom. And God will bless you for that mightily. So if you could, just lift your hand. By you, God, we're so thankful that we can come into your house and feel your presence, God, that you meet us right where we're at. God, I ask that you'd bless this tithe and this offering. God, I ask that you'd multiply, Father, this missions offering, God, that the furthering and the proclamation of the gospel would go forth, God, and there would be a mighty harvest of souls, Father, one for the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. And God, I ask that you continue to bless, continue to minister. Lord, and let your spirit break out in power and demonstration in this house today. And we pray it all in the name of Jesus.
Oh, like the veteran soldier that tears up at the sound of the national anthem, is the saint of God who's been washed in the blood of the Lamb. And when a song is sung about the blood, you go back and you remember that day that you went down in a pool of baptism and all of your sins were washed away. Somebody put it like this: sin is black as mine and blood as red as his. Wash me white as snow. There's an old song that says, thank God for the blood. Thank God for the blood. I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood that saved me. Because one day when I was lost, he died upon the cross. I know it. I know it. Lift up our hands to the Lord for a moment. Thank you, Lord. Amen. You ought to give somebody a high five. Say, thank God for the blood. Amen. I think it'd be all right if Pastor Friend came back and he said, hey, how'd church go Sunday? And you say, it was awesome. This place exploded because we started thinking about what the blood did. Amen. Thank you, Lord. James chapter 4 and verse 13. Hallelujah. I'm excited to get into the word today. The Bible says this: go to now, you that say, today or tomorrow we will go into such a city, and we will continue there a year. And we will buy, and we will sell, and we will get gain. Whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow, for what is your life? It is a vapor that appeareth for a little time, and then it vanisheth away. Jesus spoke in John 9, verse 4. He said, I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. Because the night cometh when no man can work. We have a limited opportunity in this life. Time is precious. To the man or woman who is far from God in this church today, your time is running out for that blood to work for you. But to the saint of God who is serving God and reaching your world and has a passion for lost souls, time is running out also. Because the night is coming. I'm going to preach to you today. The night is coming. Would you pray with me? Mighty God, we love you so much, and we thank you for the time to be in this sanctuary. God, we're grateful for the blood, for the sacrifice, God, that you shed on that cross that washes away our sins, and we receive it today, Lord. We're thankful for the word of God. We're thankful for what you would speak to this congregation today. Draw our souls and our hearts together towards you. God, we're looking at you. You are the object of our adoration and our affection and our worship and praise. God, draw us closer to you by the end of today. Somebody say, in Jesus' name. May be seated today. Many of us are living the average life. Somebody say average. If average life expectancy is about 85 years once you've reached 65, then that is 1,020 months. Do the math. How far along are you in? That is 4,420 weeks. That is 31,025 days, only 744,600 hours, and a mere 44,676 minutes, and it's all just passing us by. And most of us, many of us, are well into that. Unless you're a baby, you've eaten up a lot of that. Some of us have eaten up most of it. Amen. The average American will birth 1.87 children. On average, you will purchase 12 cars and you will live in 11 homes. On average, women spend 1.5 years doing their hair. More if you're Pentecostal. I grew up in a Pentecostal home with 3 girls, and there was a lot of Aquanet in there. We were single-handedly responsible for depleting the ozone layer above 45414. Women spend 8 years of their lives shopping. They'll spend 1 year after they do all that deciding what to wear. And men, you're spending that same time in the car waiting. You'll spend 3 months of your life sitting in traffic. You'll spend 1.5 years in the bathroom. Men average 4 minutes longer per day. You'll spend 14 days of your life kissing. Can I get an amen from Fusion and Hyphen? You will LOL 290,000 times in your life. And for Fusion, can you please translate? Laugh out loud. You will spend 70% of your waking life in front of digital media. That's 11 hours per day. You will watch TV for 9.1 years, 2 years of which are watching commercials. When I heard that statistic, that's the most sad statistic I ever heard. 2 years of watching someone try to sell me something that I'm not going to buy. You will work for 10.3 years, and get this, you will sleep in your lifetime 25 years that you'll sleep it away. Time. It's all about time. Time is your greatest resource. Time is the thing we have least of. Time is the thing we have to respect. How you use it, how you manage it, it's all about time. There is a time to be born, and there is a time to die. There's a time to laugh, and there is a time to cry. You can steal my phone, you can steal my car, you can steal my money, but don't waste my time. I can't get my time back. I can buy a new phone, I can get a new car, I can earn more money, but I cannot create more time. We cannot use the time we've lost, we cannot use the time we've wasted. The only thing we can use is the time we have left. And the question today is, what are you going to do with the time you have left? Life is a fleeting vapor that soon passes us by and it's gone. And it may sound a little negative, but if someone doesn't tell us that, we will forget. And while we're forgetting, hair is coming out in our brushes. And while we're forgetting, teeth are sinking into our gums. And while we're forgetting, our skin is coming loose on our faces. And if someone doesn't tell me, then time will slip by me like money through my hands, and I won't know where it went. And one day you'll be a little old lady on wobbly knees with wrinkled skin and painful joints and not know what day you got that way. Because time is like a river, and it just keeps flowing. For I assure you, you will either get old or you'll die young. So every moment is important. If you don't seize that moment and suck the life out of it ravenously and fiercely with tenacity, then it just passes you by and is wasted. The familiar expression carpe diem, Latin for seize the day, first appeared in the literary work by Horace in 23 BC. But we just read those two words, but the rest of the sentence is often ignored, which reads this way: seize the day and put very little trust in tomorrow, for no man is promised tomorrow. And the enemy would like to steal your tomorrow. And the enemy would like to steal your today. And the enemy would like to steal this moment that you have in the house and presence of God. And maybe he did for some people already, but I'm telling you today, you still have just a few more minutes to get into the presence of God and to get an audience with the King before this church service is over. You want to say, I'm going to make the most of my time. God's given me the gift of time in the house of God today, and I'm going to get something out of it. With all that value, I feel compelled to thank you for the 30 minutes you're giving me. I began to die the moment I was born. In a book called Spring Chicken, one author, he studied the process of aging. And he realized that your cells, they divide and divide and divide. But there's a limit to how many times a cell can divide. And it stops dividing and it goes into what he calls retirement. And there's a technical term for it, but essentially they stop dividing and instead they start oozing out this toxin that infects the other cells that are still trying to divide. It's kind of like how retirees get a little grumpy. I work with them all the time. I know what I'm talking about. They just get a little grumpy, you know? Nothing's quite right. And start spreading this around. And those other cells, they start slowing their rate of dividing. Oxygen, the very element I need to survive, is slowly rusting me from the inside out. And so we're taking antioxidants to combat the effects of oxygen that we need to survive. That's a difficult situation. I think that's what we call a pickle. Linda Ellis wrote a poem that became famous in 96 entitled The Dash. It says, I read of a man who stood to speak at the funeral of a friend. He referred to the dates on the tombstone from the beginning to the end. He noted that first came the date of birth, and he spoke the following date with tears. But he said what mattered most of all was the dash between those years. For that dash represents all the time that they spent alive on earth, and now only those who loved them know what that little line is worth. For it matters not how much we own, the cars, the house, the cash. What matters is how we live and love and how we spend our dash. So think about this long and hard. Are there things you'd like to change? For you never know how much time is left that can still be rearranged. If we could just slow down enough to consider what's true and real and always try to understand the way other people feel and be less quick to anger and show appreciation more and love the people in our lives like we've never loved before. If we treat each other with respect and more often wear a smile, remembering that this special dash might only last a little while. So when your eulogy is being read, when your life's actions to rehash, would you be proud of the things they say about how you spent your dash? Jesus was concerned about a young man who was spending his dash unwisely in Luke 12, verse 13. Jesus was approached by a man caught up in a family dispute over property. And verse 13 says, and one of the company said unto him, Master, speak to my brother that he divide the inheritance with me. And he said unto him, Man, who made me a judge or divider over you? And he said, Take heed, in verse 15, and beware of covetousness, for a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possesseth. Because it is not about things. We don't use people and love things. We love people and use things. It is not about things, and it is not about cars, and it is not about money and homes and fashion and popularity and position. It is about whether or not we are rich towards God. He goes on in verse 16, he spake a parable to them, saying, The ground of a certain man brought forth plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, What shall I do? I have no room wherein to bestow my fruits. Verse 18, he said, This will I do. I will pull down my barns. I will build greater. And there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. And I will say to my soul, Soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease. Eat. Drink and be merry. But God said to him, Thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Verse 21, Jesus sums up with the moral of the story. So is he that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. It's not wrong to have wealth in this earth, but I better have wealth in heaven too. So while I'm getting and gaining and building and buying, I better not forget that everything got here stays here. But the soul returns to him who made it. Whatever you earn here is going to stay here, but your soul is going back to your creator one day. The advertising firm of J. Walter Thompson of Chicago used a shock ad to gain attention, proclaiming in large type, it said, "You have 24 hours to live." In fine print underneath, it said, "Today, that is. Today. If we only had 24 hours, every hour would be precious. Every minute would be worth more than gold. Every minute would be rationed as if we were spending money like a budget." The Apostle Paul penned the words of 1 Corinthians 7:29, "But this I say, brethren," he says, "the time is short." What does Paul mean when he says those insightful prophetic words, "the time is short"? He means the time of our life is short, because the night is coming when no man can work, and the nighttime will fall like a curtain on the stage of my life, and the play will be over. The scene will end. We all think that we're immortal. It's a curious trait that we think of other people as getting old, but we don't think of ourselves as ever dying. Years ago, the Chicago Bears were coached by Mike Ditka. He was the ultimate tough guy. He had a volcanic anger until he had a massive heart attack. His response to that heart attack was shock. His body had failed him, and he says this. He was quoted as saying, "Up to that time, I thought that I was immortal, but we aren't. And we only live a few short years. As time passes, everything changes. Everything changes. If you don't believe me, attend your next high school reunion, and you'll realize how old all those other people got. They did not age well. Nothing is staying the same. Everything is changing over time. The second law of thermodynamics teaches that the universe tends towards disorder. It's falling apart, folks. It's the best argument for the concept of a creator, because he created it perfectly and it's falling apart. Things in disorder don't suddenly get organized and unionized. No, there was a creator who set it in perfect motion, and then it's going into disorder. Children are growing up and growing away. The world's getting more chaotic, more perverse, and more wicked, and everything is changing. So my question today is, what are you doing with your time? According to newspaper reports, two men, William Bell and Jacob Rosenwasser, were under sentence of death in New York. Their execution date had been set, but they felt that they would be deprived of an hour of life if they were executed on daylight saving time. So they petitioned the warden to have all the clocks in the prison changed back to the original hour so that they wouldn't lose 1 hour of precious time. What is the value of time? To realize the value of 1 year, ask a student who failed a grade. To realize the value of 1 month, ask a mother who gave birth to a premature baby. To realize the value of 1 week, ask the editor of a newspaper. To realize the value of 1 hour, ask someone sitting in the emergency room waiting area. To realize the value of 1 minute, ask a person who missed their flight. And to realize the value of 1 second, ask a person who just avoided a collision. You ought to treasure every moment that you have, because the night is coming. And time cannot be purchased by a billionaire. And time cannot be commanded by a dictator. Time cannot be controlled by a general. Time cannot be created by a scientist. And time cannot be legislated by a politician. Time can only be made. It cannot. No, time cannot be made. It can only be spent. And as you spend it, you are either wasting it or investing it. One of my favorite books is C.S. Lewis's Screwtape Letters. And the concept is this, is that there is this demon who is trying to take down a man. And he has all these different strategies in each chapter that you read. Now, as you read through it, you realize a lot of these have been levied against me at some point or another. And this demon, he asks the devil, he asks his legions, and he says, "What can we do to cause this man to fail?" And one demon pipes up from the corner of the room and says, "I know, we will tell him that there is no heaven." And the devil says, "That will never work, because inside the heart of man, they're yearning for heaven. Mankind has a built-in desire to long to be with their creator and their savior. They'll never believe that there's no heaven." So another demon speaks up from this side of the room and he says, "I know, we'll tell them there's no hell." And the devil says, "That'll never work, because Jesus, when he was on earth, he preached and taught about hell more than he taught about heaven. So they know there's ample evidence for a hell, and their sins create a demand for justice. They know a penalty is waiting. That'll never work." And so finally, a demon from the back of the room, he spoke up and he said, I'll just tell them that there's no hurry. And at this, Satan cheered and clapped his hands because he knew that that suggestion would work. But today we ruin his plan because we will remind one another of the value of time. And we'll remind the devil that we're not the only ones running out of time. He's also running out of time. Hey man, and we're looking forward to the end of days, but he is in dread of his end of days. Hallelujah. His end of days are going to come where he's going to be wrapped up and thrown in the pit. But when our end of days come, we're going to see our Savior face to face. I'm going to see my loved ones again. I'm going to walk on streets of gold. One day I'm going to see him who bled and died for me. For years, there was a simple signal that was used to alert people of the time. It was a quick strike, and a clarion ring would communicate across the fields, hey, it's time for dinner. It's time for something special. It's time to come and dine. And I'm telling you, the bell is ringing today that the night is coming. I'm telling you that the bell is ringing today. It's time to forgive somebody who's wronged you. It's time to step into the calling God has for you. If you don't have the Holy Ghost, it's time to come get filled. If you've not been healed yet, it's time to come get prayed for. I wish I had a bigger one to ring here today, but I'm telling you today that it is time to step out of the things that held you back. It's time to break out of the addictions that have held you in bondage. Today is the day. Time is too short for quarrels. Time is too quick for unforgiveness. Time is too limited for bitterness. And the night is coming, and it's time to get right. You can be seated today. On his deathbed, Alexander the Great, he summoned his army generals and he told them his three final wishes. The best doctors should carry his coffin. The wealth he has accumulated, the money and his gold and precious stones, should be scattered along the processional to the cemetery. And thirdly, his hands should be let loose so they hang outside the coffin for all to see. One of his generals, who was surprised by these unusual requests, asked Alexander to explain. And here is what Alexander the Great had to say. I want the best doctors to carry my coffin to demonstrate that in the face of death, even the greatest of physicians in the world have no power to heal. I want the road to be covered with my treasure so that everybody sees that material wealth acquired on earth will stay on earth. I want my hands to swing in the wind so that people understand that we come to this world empty-handed and we leave this world empty-handed after the most precious treasure of all is exhausted, and that is time. Man, I think we have some photos to share. I reached out to a good friend of mine yesterday and asked him if I might share his story. This church was blessed to have Matt and Jen Cooper. They attended here, and they worked closely with our young people. During a Christmas visit to Ohio, their two-year-old son, Calvin, became sick. Just go ahead and play through him. After rushing him to the ER, they learned that little Calvin had a massive brain tumor. Over the next 6 years, this devoted family traveled from state to state, including Florida, Ohio, Indiana, and Tennessee, to get Calvin the best care possible. And little Calvin endured dozens of radiation treatments, and his body suffered from an impaired immune system, difficulty breathing, and loss of balance. And the Coopers and everyone they knew poured so much love into this boy's life. And last week, they celebrated Calvin's first birthday in heaven, and he would have been 9 here on earth. Short time after losing her son, mommy Jennifer posted this comment on Facebook. On Mother's Day, she said, "Happy Mother's Day to all the wonderful mothers in my life. Today I choose to not cry tears of sadness, because this is the day the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it." I choose to humbly rejoice in the privilege to be called mommy. I choose to remember and be grateful for and celebrate each cuddle and hug and kiss and story and smile and moment that I've experienced with each of my children. I choose to pray for other mothers who are stricken with grief today and every day they no longer have with their child. And I choose to continue this prayer for all of my children because 1 Samuel says, therefore also have I lent him to the Lord, and as long as he liveth, he shall be lent to the Lord. What a perspective on our time. What a perspective on the short time she had with her son. Because parents aren't supposed to outlive their babies. But she saw that time as a blessing from God. A time to reach a life and fulfill her duty and her father's duty as a mommy and daddy. God, I want to have a proper perspective on my time. With a proper perspective on time, perhaps I wouldn't grow so impatient with the temper tantrums my children throw. With a proper perspective on time, maybe I wouldn't be so frustrated with the snotty stains left on my freshly laundered suits. With a proper perspective on time, I don't think we'd complain about having to help with procrastinated homework assignments, chauffeuring from place to place, or the loud video games echoing down the halls late at night. The laundry wouldn't be as important as those who wear it. The dishes wouldn't be as important as those who use them. I wouldn't live to work, I'd work to live. For if my loved ones were all gone, my big house I have falls silent. I'd miss the wet towel that was left in the hallway. I'd miss the Lego strewn upon the floor. Stand with me today. If everything was in its perfect place and not a figurine was disturbed, the house would be lonely. I heard the story of a church bus driver came in one day after a youth service and said, "Pastor, you got to talk to that youth pastor. Tell him to tell those teenagers to stop messing up the van, and when they leave their candy bar wrappers in it and their pop bottles in there, they got to clean that stuff up. Or they shouldn't even use our van if they can't keep it clean." The pastor said, "I'd rather have it dirty and full than clean and empty. I'd rather have them using it, going to and from camp meetings and prayer meetings and revival services and young people getting the Holy Ghost, and for everything to be perfectly in place." Many of you know that Michelle and I have two foster babies, both of whom woke up with fevers today. We hope with all our hearts that we can adopt them, but we are well aware that our time with them could be limited to just a couple of years. And it was about, I try to keep it standing long, but it was about, I don't know, maybe a week or so into it, and we asked our caseworker, what do they call you? What should they call you? Because we're not their biological parents. And the caseworker said, "Well, whatever you want them to call you." That didn't help any. I needed a rule. Tell me the rule. What should I? Male A. So I was uncomfortable, and we were sitting across the living room from each other. I told Jackson, I said, Michelle was sitting across the room. I said, "Jackson, go over to that woman over there." About 2 weeks into it, my wife, I don't know if you know her very well, she's very decisive. I'm like, "Well, you know, let's analyze this. Let's consider the pros and cons. Let's make a list." No, she's very decisive. She called me one day out of the blue. She said, "You're daddy." She said, "I'm mommy. I don't know how long we'll have them. As long as they have them, they're going to have a daddy. And they're going to have a mommy. And that's what they're going to call you." And knowing the brevity of time, we realize their observation of us may be all they're ever taught of God. It may be all they ever learn of Him. And so they're going to see a mommy and a daddy pray. And they're going to see a mommy and daddy worship in church. They're going to see a mommy and daddy who walk up to the altar every service and get something from God. And so you mommies and daddies here with your babies, and you're walking up and down as you're praying at the altar today, you carry that baby. And they may have no idea what you're saying, but they're getting something from it. They're getting something. They're learning something about the presence of God and how you approach God and how you worship Him. And you mommies that you stand there, and I know it's heavy to hold one or two all throughout a long worship service, but you hold them anyway, and you sing praises in their ears. And they can't even talk yet, but you're teaching them something about how we approach the one true God. And so you keep singing, and you keep carrying them, and you keep singing in their ears, and you keep praying with them, and they're going to watch a mommy and daddy get close to God. They're going to watch a mommy and daddy at home who love each other. Now, I don't know that today is the last day for any of us, but I know that one day will be the last day, and I don't know when that day is. I wonder if there's anybody here who's ready to take your spouse by the hand and say, you know what, today's the day. It doesn't matter if you've been an awesome spiritual leader of your home or not. Today's the day to start. It doesn't matter what mistakes you made. Husband and wife, we already know. We know everything about each other. We know what mistakes we made. It doesn't matter. Today's a new day. And time is so short. And you're running out of it. I wonder if someone is going to get somebody by the hand and say, I want to go to the altar with you. I want to go to the altar with you. I want to take my family to approach God. Go ahead and come on, bring them forth. I want to bring my family to God. I want to bring my spouse to the Lord. I want to bring my children to the Lord. As long as they live, I'm going to lend them to the Lord. I'm going to let them hear what it means to pray. I'm going to let them hear what it means to worship. I'm going to let them see what it looks like with hands raised. I'm going to let them see what it looks like to be in the presence of God. Can we get a hold of Him today with all of our hearts and all of our souls? God, today's a new day because the night is coming. I don't know when the curtain's going to fall, and I don't know when darkness is going to fall, but if you've not prayed in a long, long time, today is the day to come back. Today is the day to come back. Oh, come on, I call you today to come back to the Lord. I call you today to bring your families one more time. One more time. This is the day. This is the day. God, I'm going to seek you. You are the Lord of my life, and you're the Lord of my house. As for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord.